bind us together in love. Bind us together in love.
North, south, east, west. We are one, all of the gorilla rise. Oh, 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 oh.
It's 10:30. Good morning and welcome to St. Mark's for this service of the Word. If you were expecting Holy Communion, unfortunately, because of the removal of some tiles on the roof and the building is not quite 100% safe, I forgot my hard hat this morning, so I'm just standing here bareheaded. We've had to alter the service a little bit, and because of that, inevitably, there may be one or two little glitches, but please forgive us. The Lord's Prayer invites us to forgive those who sin against us. So if we sin against you by the little glitches, please forgive us. Only for these people in here, if the walls of Jericho should come tumbling down and there's a bit of a disaster, over to your left, the west door at the back, and the entrance you came in will then become the emergency exit you go out of. They are the safety exit points. So we welcome all those online at home, and please join in spirit and vocally if you feel constrained to do so. So let's have a little moment while we recollect ourselves and realize the presence of God among us wherever we may be. Psalm 93 says, the seas have lifted up their pounding waves, mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea. The Lord on high is mighty. And those words from Psalm 93, you can see at the tip of Beachy Head as a last plea for those who sadly might think of throwing themselves off. So let's pray. We gather in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, asking you to inspire and inhabit our praises. Teach us from your word to intercede in line with your will and draw close to us as we draw close to you. In all this, change us, enabling us to take the next step in our pilgrimage with you for the glory of Jesus. Graham.
Whatever the enemy throws at us, God is the same. And let's worship and praise him by saying who we know he is.
I believe in the resurrection. When Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
As we come to confession, I have a confession to make immediately, publicly, to you, and that is, I forgot to welcome our Archdeacon. It's good to see you, Andy, and I think that is a slight compliment that you are familiar among us now, and so you get kind of overlooked as being a visitor. So I'm sure during the interregnum, this is the second time Andy's been among us, but I'm sure it won't be the last as we trundle on in this interregnum. So I apologize, Andy, for overlooking your presence among us, and we do warmly welcome you. Psalm 41 says this, O Lord, have mercy on me, heal me, for I have sinned against you. And the confession should come up on the screen so that if you're at home, you can join with us. My God, for love of you, I desire to hate and forsake all my sins by which I have ever displeased you. And I resolve by the help of your grace to commit them no more, and to avoid all opportunities of sin. Help me to do this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If I may invite Andy to pronounce God's forgiveness over us.
Bible reminds us that as far as the east is from the west, so far does God remove our sins from us. God, you are a God of mercy. And as we have confessed our sins to you, so we pray, may we know your mercy, know your forgiveness, and know the truth that when the Son sets us free, we are free indeed. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Isn't it wonderful to be free from sin, have no guilt, and know that our sins are completely and utterly annihilated? Glory to God in the highest. Lord God, Heavenly King, we worship you. We praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, you alone are the Holy One, the Most High, Jesus Christ, in the glory of God the Father. Let us continue to worship him in song.
Lord, could save themselves. There are
Blessed be your name.
I just couldn't help thinking then that song was so appropriate for Ukrainian Christians at the present time. And now we're going to hear of another battle on the waters, and Pauline is coming to read from the Gospel of Luke for us. Thank you, Pauline.
The reading this morning is taken in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, starting at verse 22. Jesus calms the sea. One day, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side of the lake." So they got into the boat and set out. As they sailed, he fell asleep. A squall came down on the lake, so the boat was being swamped and they were in great danger. The disciples went and woke him, saying, "Master, Master, we're going to drown." He got up and rebuked the wind and the raging waters. The storm subsided and all was calm. "Where is your faith?" he asked his disciples. In fear and amazement, they asked one another, "Who is this? He commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. Lord God, we pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would lead us as we consider your word together this morning. There were a handful in church this morning or many watching online. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would help us to see Jesus, that you would help us to hear Jesus, and that you would help us to follow Jesus. We pray in his name. Amen. Well, it's great joy to be with you this morning. I'm sorry, so sorry, that for many, many of you it's online and not here in the building. St. Mark's is always a holy church, but today it's an even holier church. And I hope that the tiles get repaired soon and that bit of holiness is sorted out. This has been a week of storms, and it seems strange to be preaching this passage in this week. And for many of us, those storms have been the physical storms around us, particularly on Friday. But for some of us too, this will be a week where the storms will have been personal. They will be in our storms, things that are affecting us personally or in our families or amongst our friends. As you come to think about this passage this morning, I want just to read one other passage first of all. So this is from Jonah. Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Then the Lord sent a great wind to the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God, and they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, "How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us, so we will not perish." Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" He answered, "I'm a Hebrew. I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." This terrified them, and they asked, "What have you done?" They knew he was running away from the Lord because he'd already told them so. The sea was getting rougher and rougher, so they asked him, "What should we do to make the sea calm down for us?" "Pick me up, throw me into the sea," he replied, "and it will become calm. I know that it's my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Two ships, two men, both sleeping, two storms, and then some differences in the storms. One is in a place of obedience. One is in a place of disobedience. One is in a place of peace. One is in a place of guilt. One calms the storm from a place of relationship. One rediscovers relationship in the storm, and it is calmed. And as we consider those two different stories of two people in a storm, Jesus in the boat, Jonah in the boat, what is it that we learn together this morning? Jesus is in the will of the Father. He is doing the things that God has invited him to do. And there's a sense of communion and community between Jesus and his Father as he tracks his journey. He is supposed to be on the lake. He is on a journey, and this boat trip is part of that journey. He knows he's where he's supposed to be, and therefore when a storm disrupts, it doesn't disrupt God's will, doesn't disrupt God's plans. There's no sense of, oh no, what have I done wrong? Jesus knows the storm is there, but he's relaxed about his Father's will. Jonah has heard the voice of God, doesn't like what he's heard, and has run off in another direction. Moment for a trailer. I'm going to teach online later this spring a 4-evening series on Jonah. So if you're interested in knowing more about Jonah, watch the Darston News and you'll get a Zoom link for a course that I'm teaching. Jonah hears God's voice and heads off in a different direction. He is in a place of disobedience. Sometimes for us, we can be as dramatic as Jonah. We hear God ask us something. We hear God say something to us, and we head in the opposite direction. Sometimes we just move slightly off course. I heard a wonderful story of somebody whose family used to sail. One of the things they used to do was to sail from the east coast of England to the Netherlands for part of their summer holiday. And one year they set off and they sailed at night because it was safer, oddly, because all the lights on the ships made it safer than sailing in the daytime. So one night they set off to cross the North Sea to the Netherlands. And as the day broke, they looked at land and thought, that doesn't look quite right. And as they got closer, they discovered that they were not heading towards the Netherlands, but towards Belgium. They had made a very slight error in setting their compass, only by a few degrees. And at the beginning, those few degrees made very little difference. But by the time they crossed the North Sea, they landed in a different country. And sometimes our disobedience is not as dramatic as Jonah's heading off in the opposite direction. Sometimes it's just moving away from God's will. But eventually we find ourselves in the wrong place. Where are you? Where are we? Are we relaxed in God's will as Jesus was? Or dramatically running away from it as Jonah was? I've done quite a lot of work over the last years helping couples who are preparing for marriage. And one of the things we talk about when we do marriage preparation is that couples coming to marriage think that what they bring is normal. So when my wife and I got married, we discovered one of those normals that was completely different in our two families. In my family, if you're not feeling well, you go to bed. Okay? Almost immediately, you know, as soon as tummy or head or any other bit of your body is just slightly out of sync, you go to bed. And you stay in bed until you feel better. In my wife's family, it's the last thing you do. If you're not well, you sit in an armchair. At best, actually, you don't stop at all. You just keep going. And it was really interesting as we kind of began to negotiate married life, discovering this really big difference between what we did when we weren't well. And I ran to bed, and Margaret didn't. And as we think about this story, we recognize that both Jesus and Jonah in the story I read secondly, both end up asleep. Both of them are in a place where they are resting. And I want to be really careful as I draw out from this, because I know that for some of us, issues of health and sometimes even of mental health will affect our sleep and the way in which we see sleep. But in these two accounts, Jesus sleeps because everything about him is at rest. He knows the will of the Father. He knows this is a moment to rest for what comes next. And Sabbath is a rest for what comes next. It's not an exhausted stop, I'm worn out. It's a getting ready for what comes next. And as Jesus rests on the boat, he is preparing for the next thing that God has for him. When Jonah rests on the boat, he's hiding. A bit like Adam and Eve in the garden, he's kind of hiding from God. And hiding from the sense of guilt that he's feeling because he knows he's in the wrong place. When the storm comes, Jesus is remarkably relaxed. And some of us will have different stories about how people regarded Friday's storm. But Jesus, in the midst of this storm, is relaxed because he knows the storm is not going to overwhelm them because God has a bigger purpose. And because he's on this journey that God has ordained, he knows that the storm is not going to disrupt that journey. It might be a bit uncomfortable, but it's not going to disrupt God's ultimate plans. He knows God, and therefore he knows that he is safe and the disciples on the boat are safe. Jonah moves into this place of hiding. Surrounded by the panic of the sailors, he can't even pray until the sailors encourage him. And I guess all of that raises for us the question of what goes on in our lives. How do we see the storms and what happens in the midst of those storms? We know from the physical experience the last few days that we don't avoid storms. That we're not storm-proof like the coats you might buy from Millets. We are going to be there when the storm comes. But the question is, where is God when we are in the storm? Looking at him, looking for him, knowing his presence with us. Sometimes storms disrupt us. And for Jonah, the storm was disruptive. It was that reminder that he was out of God's will. We have to be careful, though, and Jesus' story is a helpful one to recognize that not every storm is about us being out of God's will. The storms aren't always about that. And the things that assail us are not always like that either. When we're sick, when life is difficult, it doesn't always mean that we're in a place of disobedience. Storms happen. And storms happen even for Jesus. In Jonah's case, yes, we do know that the storm was about getting him into the right place. And God does that in an extraordinary way. We know that in chapter 2, God sends a fish, and it's the fish that gets Jonah eventually to the place that God wants him. So what's going on in your life right now? Are you in a place of rest with God as Jesus was? On this Sabbath, are you resting so that God can lead you into his will in the week ahead? Or are you hiding? Whether by a few degrees or 180 degrees, you know that you're out of sync with God and you're hiding from him. And God's invitation is come back. Come back. Come home. Let me help you to rediscover the path that you are supposed to be on. Are we in a place of trying to escape, or are we in a place of rest? When the storms come, are we clinging to God, who we know is our Father? Or are we being woken up to a place of disobedience? The storms are both calmed. One, because Jesus speaks peace to nature. One, because Jonah, in obedience, allows himself to be placed into the water and into God's will for what comes next in his life. I wonder what God would be saying to us this morning in the situations that we are in. Many of us in that place of rest with Jesus. Some of us in that place of running and hearing God's voice say, come home. Let's pray. Lord God, you know that we have experienced the physical storm of the last few days. Some of us are very conscious of some of the storms around our world right now. Political shifts, environmental shifts, things which are affecting equilibrium. And some of us are conscious of the particular storms in our own lives. We pray like Jesus, may we find those places of rest with God, of rest in his will, of rest in preparation for what he has next. And Lord, I pray this morning for those who, like Jonah, are running, and pray that they may hear your voice inviting them home, inviting them back to your will, inviting them to that place of alignment with you. Lord, we pray for your rescue and for renewed relationship with you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to thank the team that led us in song worship this morning, because the songs we've sung have so much underlined some of what I was trying to say this morning. But there's another song that you might just want to look for on YouTube, just to kind of pick up some of the theme of this morning. Graham Kendrick's song, For This We Have Jesus, speaks of some of the things that I've been talking about. And you might just want to use that song sometime in the next few days just to reflect on your journey. Bless you.
Rather than just rush on to the next thing, let's just hold our thoughts, something that God has impressed on our minds during Andy's sermon, and let it embed itself in our thinking and in our behavior. So let's just have a few moments now of quiet while we just reflect on what we've just heard.
Upon the waters, wherever you would go.
faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior.
Let's pray. At the end of each of the intercessions, there's a little versicle and response for you to make you part of the prayer verbally as well as spiritually. And when I say, Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you, respond, let your will be done. Let us bring our world, the needs of others, and our own requests in faith before Jesus, who intercedes for us before the throne of God. King of kings and Lord of lords, before whom all the nations are but a drop in a bucket, we bring to you the peoples and governments of countries where there is tension, division, unrest, and instability. We name before you Ukraine, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Syria, Iran, Nigeria, Myanmar, Somalia, Zimbabwe, Egypt, and Cuba. Bring your sovereign influence to bear on the unruly wills of human beings. Restore peace. Bless the peacemakers. Strengthen justice. Overthrow corruption to the end that people may live their lives in peace and security. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you, let your will be done. We bring your people, the church, to you throughout the world. Especially we pray for our sisters and brothers who are tortured, persecuted, discriminated against, and sidelined because of their faith in you. Deliver from their captors those who are being held against their will. Strengthen those languishing in prisons. Encourage those who endure. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. On this United Nations Day of World Social Justice, highlighting the need for formal employment, we bring to you, our Heavenly Father, all those who struggle to secure regular employment, including some in this church. Guide those in need of employment to find roles suitable to their skills, and for those with influence to create long-term job prospects so that they may find fulfillment in contributing to society. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. Father, we commend to your tender compassion all those who have lost loved ones, especially children, through illness, accident, carelessness, disaster, the violence of others, addiction, and those who have no closure on their loss. Draw close to them in their sorrow and grief, so that they may find light in their darkness, comfort in their distress, and support in their time of need. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. We bring to you those experiencing the storms of life, amidst circumstances over which they have no control. As you restored tranquility on the lake, so take control of their situations and those instrumental in them, bringing peace to them and the turbulence surrounding them. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. We pray for Sadhu in the early days of his new ministry. Move him by your power of your Spirit to build up the churches of Leicestershire by teaching, vision, and example. And just as Sadhu begins his new ministry, we pray for Archdeacon Paul Wright of Bromley and Bexley, and formerly of St. Augustine's up the road, who retires this afternoon. Thank you for his service for you in the diocese, and we commend him and his wife to enjoy a long and fulfilling retirement. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. And now let us have 30 seconds to bring our own concerns to God in quietness and the privacy of our own hearts. Sovereign Lord, we cry out to you. Let your will be done. And we pray the collect for the second Sunday before Lent. Almighty God, you have created the heavens and the earth and made us in your own image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works and your likeness in all your children. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns supreme over all things, now and forever. Amen. And we join all our prayers together in the words that Jesus taught us. And I see we have the traditional words up, so join in. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
For our final song, God is one who has the power.
All that you've done for me.
For those of us that are in the building, please sit. I'm sure you're already sitting in your armchair or settee at home. Now we come to the point of notices, or family news, as we like to term it. As this church building is closed to other people for worship, other than us actually doing the service, we cannot read the bands because it would be illegal to do so. So that the bands will be read next week. On Sunday next, the 27th, is Gospel Night. So I think we have a clip coming up, which you can see at home as well. Maiwa is going to obviously be featuring in that a lot.
Would you like to know more about how the grace of God can overcome any obstacle? Why don't you join us at St. Mark's Gospel Night for a night of unhindered praise and worship led by a gospel band themed Great Grace on Sunday, the 27th of February from 6:25 p.m. at St. Mark's Church, 1 Canterbury Street, ME75TP. On tour and ministering is MC Godwin Favor. Looking forward to seeing and welcoming you.
It's going to be a full-on experience, and hopefully we'll raise the roof, but not too high because we've got tiles on there that are rather loose. The other notice concerning the choirs, Mara was putting a community choir together, and rehearsals start on Monday, the 28th of February, via Zoom. And now all the rehearsal dates are shown on posters in the church and online. So if you connect to our website, you'll see all the dates there. And please contact Maiwa for the Zoom link so that you'll be able to join in singing online. Sounds interesting. Tomorrow is the last day to make your submission about the type of vicar you would like to have here. And there on our website, there is a link, stmarksgillingham.org/interregnum. And if you click on that, you can download a form or fill it in online with your views on the type of vicar we would like. Thursday is Anne Fordham's funeral at 1:30 at Medway Crematorium and 2:30 here in church in the form of a memorial service. Anne has been a member of this church for many years. She resided in St. Mark's House just outside, and if you scratching your head to wonder who she might be, she often had a motorized little buggy thing, and she sometimes sat over there or up there. So it might just trigger your memories. Oh yes, I know, I could place her face, but I didn't know her name. But that was Anne Fordham. And it would be nice and a good witness to the family if a number of us could come and pay our respects to her at her funeral service. As you might expect, there's no prayer ministry in the side chapel after the service, but please let us know if you do need prayer, and we'll include it. There's a thing you can type in on the side of the of Facebook. Right, I think we've come to the end of our service now. I'm getting a nod from Graham that he's not expecting to lead us in any more worship. So again, with our renewed thanks to our Archdeacon Andy, and I'm going to now ask him to bless us and dismiss us. Thank you, Andy.
Let's pray. We declare this day that the Lord is our God. We will walk in his ways. We will keep his decrees. We'll obey his commands and live by his laws. The Lord declares this day that you are his own, his treasured possession, a people holy to the Lord your God, as he promised in Jesus Christ our Savior. And now may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest upon each of you this day and through this week. Amen.